You are not God. Good morning. Welcome to Canonsburg UP Church. It's great to see everyone today. I'm Katie Smarzak, for anyone that does not know. Thank you for joining us for worship. If you are a guest with us today, if you have a prayer request or a question regarding an event or ministry, please fill out one of our connection cards. You can find them right over there at the entrance. Our team would love to have a chance to connect with you. And if you can now join me for the call to worship. When the princes in Israel take the lead, when the people willingly offer themselves, praise the Lord.
Hear this, you kings. Listen, you rulers. I, even I, will sing to the Lord. I will praise the Lord, the God of Israel, in song.
Together we have gathered to sing and shout the praises of our gracious Father.
We praise Jesus, who willingly offered himself in love.
We worship the Lord who is present today in the Holy Spirit, the three in one. Let's continue to sing.
Thank you.
Please join me now for our unison prayer of confession. O God, in our daily lives, we forget you, our King. Too often, we just do what we see fit. We run our own way without thought or concern for you, for your creation, or our fellow travelers. As we turn our hearts and minds to you today, renew in us your Spirit, and let the mess of our own making melt away. Friends, the Lord by the Spirit is refining you in the fire of his love. Trust and believe that you are being made new, and even now you are truly loved, forgiven, and free.
And at this time, I want to invite the children of the church to come forward and have a seat here up front for our children's moment. How you guys doing this morning? Excellent, excellent. I see we got a girls' section and a boys' section going on here. That's all right. You can come a little bit closer if you want. Here, you know what? Just in case there's anybody, any kids online, I'm going to sit over. Why don't you come a little bit closer, right? Because you can't hear me from all the way back there. I got a question for you. I realize I ask a lot of questions. Do you notice that? Yeah, I ask a lot of questions. You guys have a lot of answers. So I figured it's kind of a good one too, right? Okay, so does anybody have any idea what's special about this weekend? Go ahead.
That is Halloween.
Ooh, Halloween. You're close. We've got, I don't even know what day it is. I think it's the 8th, Let's pretend it's the 8th of March.
Yeah, it's
the 8th. You're good. Yeah, so.
Because yesterday was the 7th.
Because yesterday was the 7th. That's how math works, isn't it? Yeah, well done. So, Halloween is the 31st, right? So, 31 minus 8 is how is what? You don't know. That's all right. That's all right. You know it. Come on. Close. 8, 22 would make it what? 8 plus 22 would be how many? 23 days. Yes, you're right. That's right. So 23 days till Halloween still. Yeah, I know. That's all right, though. And if you went into Home Depot even last weekend, you'd think it was Christmas. But so no, not quite Halloween. Something else special about this weekend right here. Anything? This church, yeah, that's awesome. I mean, that's never a bad answer. So I'm even giving you a high five for that one. But that's not what I was looking for. There's something else special, unique about this weekend.
We don't have school.
You don't have school. Oh, that's right. What's that, Al?
We have a three-day weekend.
You have a three-day weekend. You know why you have a three-day weekend? I'm going to tell you right now. Thanksgiving. Oh, you don't think so, but I can tell you that despite Kenton's loud voice behind me, I know I'm right.
No.
This weekend is Thanksgiving. Oh, it is. On Friday night, I had a turkey. We had two different kinds of stuffing. Green bean casserole. We had potatoes. No, I didn't just have it for fun. This is Thanksgiving. Oh, yeah, I am expanding your mind. Thanksgiving weekend, 100%. Thanksgiving weekend. Now, it's celebrated in Canada. It's, some people would say, Canadian Thanksgiving. But it's Thanksgiving. I know. That's a great face. You got to patent that one. That's a really good one. It's Thanksgiving weekend. In Canada, they celebrate Thanksgiving. We, the Canadian, celebrate it in October. And here down in the U.S., what month do we celebrate Thanksgiving usually?
November,
very good, yeah. But do you know what? Man, October, November, there's no special month, actually. In fact, the history of celebrating Thanksgiving has happened all over the place, many different times of the year. Various presidents over the years have declared a certain day of giving thanks for what we got. It just happened that, you know, after many, many years, they decided we're going to make one special day a day to give thanks. But you know what? It's not just meant to be for one day or one month. You know, as followers of Jesus, we have a whole lot to be thankful for. And we don't have to limit it to just one day or one month. We can be thankful all the time for absolutely everything that we have. Whether it's a cool new shirt, or sweet new shoes, or awesome barrettes, or amazing Crocs, or a cool plaid shirt that celebrates the Hamilton Tiger Cats, because I know that's what the yellow and black is for around here, 100%. You know, whatever we have, we can give thanks for. Or for parents who love us, or grandparents, right? Or aunts and uncles, or friends, or even getting an extra day off of school, which I know you guys are going to use to have some amazing fun.
I always thought Thanksgiving was after Halloween.
After Halloween, yes. But I gotta tell you, you don't have to wait to be thankful. You don't have to wait till November, almost the end of November, to be thankful. You can be thankful right here, right now, this day, and every day. Okay? All right. And you know what? If your parents will make it for you, you can make a Thanksgiving dinner anytime you want as well. Let's pray. Dear God. Thank you. You have given me so much. And I am grateful for all that I have that comes from you. Thank you. And help me to be thankful always. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you guys may go back where your families have a wonderful Thanksgiving weekend. That's right, yeah. Now, as our I apologize. We've got some people that are up and ready, but you jumped the gun a little bit. I got a couple of things we got to do before. Yeah, I know. It's It's all, Dan, it's almost like it says that in the bulletin. Yeah, it's in there. You don't believe me, just like Thanksgiving. But it's the truth. Today we have a couple of things. The first of which is we're taking a moment out to celebrate and give thanks for a wonderful staff that we have here at the church. And you'll see in your bulletin that there is a picture. It's kind of like, oh, I don't know, going back to school. You've got a face, and then you've got a name, and you've got a bit of a job description, and you've got the number of days they've been with us. That's as of today. We've got our director of Up With Kids daycare, Elena Zyra, at 97th day. I mean, she just got out of purgatory. She's been a wonderful addition to our church, to our daycare. She's been amazing. Karen Jingleski, who usually attends worship at the 11 o'clock service, as does Elena. Karen, stepped in, as some of you might know, stepped in at a time of transition with our finances and got us in ship shape. She's been a godsend, really, to our church, and she's been a member for much longer than 1,400 days, but when the need arose, she stepped in. Kathy Stewart, my goodness. Kathy, when she was hired as Director of Family Ministries, had no idea all that she'd be getting into, as she even stepped in to help out with our daycare during a time of transition, and has been phenomenal. What a bright and cheerful attitude she brings to this church. Jeremy Miller, it's crazy to imagine how many days that he's been custodial help in our sanctuary. Now, obviously, we don't have a sanctuary that needs cleaning right now. We have a sanctuary. It's not needing to be cleaned yet, but Jeremy's been helping out in other ways. He's been cleaning down here in our fellowship hall. Nicole Siphon, who's not even Nicole Siphon anymore. This summer, she got married. She's now Nicole Underwood. And she has been with us for just a little bit longer than Jeremy, serving to care for children and toddlers during our worship service. We've got Megan Lonich, who predates me just by a tiny little bit on staff, but she grew up in this church. And she stepped in to serve as choir director and has been doing so in a wonderful way and expanded her service in so many ways. Didn't play the guitar before, just a little bit. She knew three chords, four chords. What was the fourth chord? A? Okay, A, yeah. G? Oh, G, D, C, E minor. That's four chords. That's right. Yeah, A. So.
She's here 10 years this week.
10 years this week. That's right, yeah. I can't do that math that quickly. That's 10 years this week. That's pretty awesome. Stephanie Wooden, who is our director of communications, and oftentimes when you're getting communication from the church, it's coming by way of Stephanie, even if it doesn't say that. She has a hand in virtually everything that gets out into the public. And then, of course, Pam Walker, who scheduled her vacation around our celebration of our staff. That's right. She decided the perfect time to go visit the West Coast was when we were going to celebrate our staff. That's not entirely true. That's where she is, but she's visiting her son and daughter-in-law and granddaughter, and we're very glad to be able to do that. So make sure that when you see her, that you give her extra special attention, because you know how much she loves that. So that is our staff. We are so... Did I miss someone? Of course, 18,000 days... I do not believe that. I honestly went in the session records this week to try and find out the actual date. There's nothing in there. I really think Ken just showed up one day, started playing, and then he said, "Oh, you forgot to write me a check," and he's just been on staff ever since. But you know, yeah, it's a dubious start date that we have in our records. But you know, hey. I guess he's here, so we might as well pay him. But we are really grateful. We have a tremendous staff who do such great work. And, you know, we get to gather and worship. We get to grow in our faith in large part because of what they do. And so for those that are here this morning, I would like, let's see, that are available. I know, is Nicole across the way, Kathy? Yeah. Okay, Nicole's across the way. Megan, why don't you come forward here? And Kenton, Kathy, would you, all of you guys are going to be back later, so I'm not going to, I have nothing for you. I've got some for Nicole. Jeremy, is Jeremy, I saw him earlier. He's Jeremy. Yeah, would you come up? I'm going to give you something. Everybody else, we're just going to stand in front of us. What's that? You have to come back. If you want to get something, you have to come back to the second service.
I don't mean anything. I got a reason.
You got a that perfect. Jeremy, this is just a little something from our church to show appreciation. So would you do me a favor? And before you sit down, can we just we want to pray for you. So if you would you do me a favor? Just kind of reach out your hand as a way of support. God, we are so grateful for this staff, those that are standing before us today, and those that couldn't be with us or will be with us a little bit later. God, we pray that you continue to strengthen them, God, with peace and with joy, God, with love, that they might be able to serve you in this place. And wherever they go, back out to their homes and their neighborhoods, God, with that love, that they might help us in their service to draw closer to you and be more faithful as we seek to serve you and grow ourselves, God. We pray that you would bless them and keep them safe. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Now, I noticed you skipped picture.
There's nobody else that you need to mention there.
So I am here on behalf of the Worship and Music Committee and the rest of the staff to acknowledge Pastor Don, because originally October is considered Pastor Appreciation Month traditionally, but in your great leadership, you have decided to kind of flip it and appreciate the rest of us. But we want to take time to thank you for your service and all that you do for us. We realized that when you left us for 11 weeks. We weren't floundering, but we realized just how much you do, and we are glad that you are back leading the charge through the mess that is all of our renovations and improvements. So I have a card for you. I'll show it to you, but you guys go back to the next service to get it. So if we could all show a moment of appreciation for Pastor Don.
Thank you. Now I want to hand it over. I'm sorry. Still more exercise. But one more person is something completely different. Dick Holtman.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm up here today to give you a financial update after three quarters of the year. We have a consistent history of being behind in October and expenses being more than income. But we have encouraging news because we're not as far behind as we were last year or many other years. Even more encouraging is the faithfulness that you have shown every year with your fourth quarter giving that usually erases the deficit and we finish the year with income to carry over into the new year. So right now, income trails expenses by about $28,000. The biggest factor is income from our gas lease came in $20,000 less than what we expected. So last year was a boom year for gas. This year, not as much. Overall, giving is slightly higher compared to last year, and our expenses are within reason. So I want to think a little bit now about how God has blessed this church family. Consider the dedicated, faithful members seated all around you, and the dedicated pastor and our staff. We are so blessed. I'll close with a little childhood example. When I was in junior high school, my allowance was $2 a week. So we're going back to like 1962, 3, 60 some years ago. Out of that, I could pay for my milk at lunch because I was a brown bagger. A little carton of milk was 4 cents, so 8 cents a day I took out of my allowance and paid for my milk at lunchtime. If I had money left over, I could, you know, accumulate it, save it up for something for my hobbies or things like that. When I got a Christmas present or a birthday present or something special, it didn't buy my milk. It would be used for something special for me, something I chose, something out of the ordinary. I want to draw a parallel to the tremendous gift we've received from Frank DeZomba's estate, a gift that's paid for these renovations down here, the ones that are coming upstairs, money that will go far beyond what is our typical ministry. We're not going to be using that money to pay for electricity, for a cleaning contract, or for salaries. That responsibility is on us as members of God's kingdom. So the session will continue to seek God's guidance in how to use these funds to build his kingdom. And I want to give thanks for your faithfulness and your generosity and encourage you as we finish out the year that we will come out well. At this time, we're going to ask the ushers to come forward and receive our offering.
For all that you've given to us. We thank you so much for the opportunity we have to be in this place, to be surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, both those that are with us in person and those whose memory is so long with us. God, we pray that you would use these gifts that we've returned to you this morning to multiply those that have come to know you, to trust in you, and to receive and experience your love and forgiveness. God, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Before you sit down, I want you to take a quick moment to say hello to somebody around you. Again, and welcome to Canonsburg UP Church. A couple of announcements I want to get you. The very first, most important thing, though, is an apology. I hung Dan Reynolds out to dry this morning, and he let me know that payback is really not a good thing. So I messed up with a former member of the Army, and if my body doesn't turn up, you should know. Here we go. I got a thumbs up. I got a thumbs up for Dan. I'm so grateful to have you back, Dan. Missed you last week. Actually, there's a couple of announcements I want to share with you. First off is, as Alec mentioned, Halloween is coming up, but we're kind of celebrating it early. Trunk or Treat is going to be October 21st from 3 to 4:30 up in the upper parking lot. If you would like to open your trunk up, hopefully decorated, and offer candy to kids or, I guess, anybody who shows up, let Kathy Stewart know in the office because we would love to have you as a part of that. If you got kids, bring them out at 3 o'clock. It's going to be a lot of fun, so mark that in your calendars. A little renovation update. The restrooms are still unavailable today, but, cross all your fingers, your toes, pray. Maybe by next Sunday, we might be able to have these restrooms available. Of course, three floors of restrooms next door, so if you need to, they are all available for your use throughout the Sunday and the week. Renovations are happening, getting closer and closer. But still within the same time frame of our expectations, we're probably going to have, as you've dealt with renovations before, I'm sure, in your life, we're going to have some lulls, as different teams, their schedule makes their way to us. So there might be a little bit of a lull in the coming weeks upstairs. In fact, next week, a little bit less going on. But carpets and reupholstery and different little things are going to be happening, and we're still hopeful that we should be in for the season of Advent. So that still remains our plan and our goal. Nothing's changed from that. And then one other thing, hey, prayer. We are a church that prays. Prays for you when you're in need, which is why if you have a need, whether it's those prayer cards, those information cards that are at the entrances and exits this morning, you could fill that out or contacting the church office. We pray. We pray in worship, but also throughout the week. We invite you to share with us your needs so we can be in prayer. This Monday, also, the prayer team is going to start back up. We'll be meeting this Monday, information in your bulletin. If you'd like to be a part of that, come on out. There's always an open invitation. But also, I would ask that, especially this season, that you would be praying for the nominating team. Nominating team has been meeting three meetings already. The big thing that they've done so far is praying. And they will continue to do this. They have been studying the scripture together, getting to know each other, praying, and have started to turn to pray for you and potential leaders. And so I would invite you to pray for them, is that they help to discern whom God is calling to help serve and lead in the church in the coming years. It is a vital ministry that we have. And certainly if you have those that you think God might be calling to positions of leadership, reach out to the church office and we will pass those along 100%. Make a little bit of a turn here Maggie mentioned that we're in this season and this series talking about messes. And it is so cool to be able to see our own messes kind of get a little bit tidied up and cleaned up. But whether it's a physical, literal mess or it is our lives, I think we are all, we'll recognize that we live in and amongst messy things. Our lives are messy. And one of the things, and I will say this until I draw my last breath, I love about the Bible is that it tells us stories of messy people, messy experiences. It is so great that we can open up the scriptures and read about real people who had really messy experiences. It helps, I think, us to feel like we belong. That our mess doesn't preclude us from being part of God's story. It doesn't preclude us from being part of God's community. And so I'm grateful for that. But it's uncomfortable. Right? It's uncomfortable, actually, to read. It would be so much nicer, in some ways, if people just open up the scriptures and see how everything was so perfect and so worked out. That there would be another level of comfort that we could gain from that. But God steps in to the mess. Ongoing, on a regular basis, God engages. And God doesn't remove us from our mess. And God doesn't necessarily, in a snap of a finger, make everything turn out perfectly. God wades in and engages. And God does it in some surprising ways. We read the stories of the scripture, and I think we can be uncomfortable for a couple of reasons. I think one reason that we become uncomfortable with some of the things that we read in the scripture is because we have our own experiences and culture that are not the same as what is necessarily happening 2,000, 4,000, 6,000 years ago in various different cultures, right? And there are some things in there, like what to eat or what to drink or what to do or what to say, that we read them and we go, ooh, like that. Perfect example, right? We're all familiar with, or most of us are familiar, with the story of what Jesus did on the night that he was betrayed when he celebrated communion. Before that, he did something. He washed all of his disciples' feet. You want to make, especially Presbyterians, uncomfortable, you suggest that you have a foot washing service. You have never heard people in leadership, faithful Christians, come up with an excuse so quickly than how they should not be engaged in a foot washing service. It's funny. We've got all these reasons because we're uncomfortable, right? But this is another reason why I think when we read things in the scripture, we become uncomfortable, and I think that's because of Jesus. There are things, especially in the Old Testament, that we read and we're like, oh my goodness. And I think that's because we have, even without knowing it, been affected by the way Jesus lived his earthly life, served in a humble, caring way, in a sacrificial way. When we see things like violence and war that happen in the scriptures, it's fair for us to go, I don't know how comfortable I am with this, right? It is difficult. It is not easy. There are no easy answers in the scriptures. And I think, especially in light of recent events this weekend, right? You see the news and we become very uncomfortable because we have in us this sense of compassion and care, especially for the underdog. I think, actually, I'm reminded of sports. You know, I think one of the reasons why so many people cheer for the underdog in sports is because we have been affected by that whole mentality. The scriptures tell so many stories about the underdog and how God is for the least, the lost, the left behind. That is whom God cares for. That is who God empowers. That is whom God blesses. The rest don't need it, right? The Yankees, they've got their $10 billion payroll. And the fact that they missed the playoffs is not a bad thing. We cheer instead for the Pirates or the Tigers. But, you know, the messiest time in Israel's history is told about throughout the book of Judges. The book of Judges is a mess. This is the season after God's people had left slavery and bondage in Egypt, that they had wandered for 40 years in the wilderness because they had not been faithful, because they hadn't been willing to step out in courage to follow God's invitation and clear direction. So they wandered in the desert for 40 years until basically all those who had said, I'm not quite sure about this, I don't think I can follow God, had died off, and a new generation rose up. But even that, it was messy. They got into the promised land, and it's messy. And then they divide out into their own to their own tribes, and they go to this land that's been given to them. But, well, they kind of start to forget about how they got there. They start to forget about who led them there. They start to forget who is supposed to be in charge. God. And they start to look to the ways of people around them, and they start to say, hey, you know what? These crops are happening, and maybe it's because this people have done these certain rituals and prayed to these other gods and whatnot. Maybe we should just do that too. And in the book of Judges, it has this cycle, and it goes all over and over and over again. And it kind of looks like this. The people are in difficulty because they have turned away from God. And so they experience a lot of problems. Raiders come into the land, and they realize that they are being stomped out and beaten up. And so they cry out to God for help. And God raises up in response to that a leader who listens to God and follows God. And this turns the circumstances and the situation of the nation around, or at least a group of tribes around, and they start to get things in order. And for the length of the time of the life of this leader, they're referred to as a judge, things are going well. And then the judge dies, and the people forget. And they start to follow after the local gods and forget about God. And then all of a sudden, they start to get into trouble. And they cry out again to God. There's a great little, I'm just going to invite you to listen to this, from Judges chapter 2, this description early on. It says, then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hands of these raiders. Yet they would not listen to their judges, but prostituted themselves to other gods and worshiped them. They quickly turned from the ways of their ancestors, who had been obedient to the Lord's commands. Whenever the Lord raised up a judge for them, he was with the judge and saved them out of the hands of their enemies as long as the judge lived. The Lord relented because of their groaning under those who oppressed and afflicted them. But when the judge died, the people returned to the ways even more corrupt than those of their ancestors, following other gods and serving and worshiping them. They refused to give up their evil practices and stubborn ways. This is a kind of an overview, and we see it many, many times throughout the book of Judges, this exact same thing happening. And in some of the most famous judges that we're aware of, Gideon and Samson, are a part of this. And even in their lives, it's very interesting, even in their lives, they seem to be along the way ensnared by their own hubris. Sometimes they get to experience something really good, and they're at the forefront of something good, and they forget how they got there. They forget that it was the Lord. It wasn't their own strength. It wasn't their own wisdom. It wasn't some special garment that did it. It was the Lord. And actually, from the beginning to the end of the book of Judges, it kind of gets worse. In fact, the last couple of chapters, it is just messy, does not do it justice. But kind of in the middle of this, there is a pair of leaders that are different, unique. The fact that they're together talked about is pretty unique in and of itself. These are the leaders of Deborah and Barak. Deborah was a prophet, and she was a judge. She, it said that, sat under the tree of Deborah. you have to be somewhat well-known to have a very tree named after you. But it was there that she would listen to the disputes of the community and empowered by God, would be able to make judgments about which party in this dispute was in the right or how, you know, things should be allocated. And Barak was a military commander. He was doing his best, fighting to keep his family and his community safe from these raiders. Deborah, when we're first introduced to her, has a word from the Lord. And she calls out and invites Barak to come. She demonstrates, I think, something that is so important and is demonstrated so many times throughout the scriptures, really what a prophet so often does, which is the courage to speak truth to those who are in positions of power. Now, often prophets in the scriptures are speaking a hard truth, a difficult word, a challenge to people in positions of power. Deborah's word is not necessarily that way. Deborah's word is kind of actually an encouragement and a piece of instruction. She basically says, here is the way that God is going to hand over your enemies to you if you do this thing, if you follow this particular path. And she is not only willing to speak up, but she has this information. And I think one of the root reasons why she is able to do this is that she has kept an intimate relationship with God. You know, the scriptures over and over show us that we will know and understand a true prophet. Again, not necessarily someone who tells the future. This is not a fortune teller. But a prophet is one who speaks on behalf of God. You will know that they are a faithful prophet about whether what they say actually comes true. The outcome will determine whether or not. So if Deborah is to give an instruction to Barak, you'll know that she's faithful if the instruction, when it's carried out, happens the way she had said. It'd be very easy then to judge whether she is a faithful prophet or not. If Barak follows her lead and does these things and it turns out as she has said, then obviously she's speaking for the Lord. And if not, then she's not. There's a history of unfaithful prophets who only tickle the ears of the leadership, right? Deborah is actually an example of a faithful prophet who speaks on behalf of God. She offers both a word of encouragement and a word of instruction to Barak. This is how to follow God in this moment, in this time. Now, I'd love for us actually together to read what happens next. It's in your bulletins there. It's Judges chapter 4, beginning at verse 8. I'd love for you, if you're able, to stand up and for us to read these three verses together. Let's pay attention as we read. Barak said to her, if you go with me, I will go. But if you don't go with me, I won't go. Certainly, I will go with you, said Deborah. But because of the course you are taking, the honor will not be yours. For the Lord will deliver Sisera into the hands of a woman. So Deborah went with Barak to Kadesh. There Barak summoned Zebulun and Naphtali, and 10,000 men went up under his command. Deborah also went up with him. You may be seated. I want to offer a great word of encouragement to you. You did what I've often said. When you encounter names in the Bible that you're just not sure about, just say it confidently. Everybody else will say, oh, that's how you pronounce it. All about, well, courage, I guess, right? So here's the situation, right? Deborah says, listen, this is what you need to do. You need to gather 10,000 men. You need to go to this place. And the Lord has said that your enemy, Sisera, is the general in charge of these this raiding army. The Lord will give them into your hands if you just do this. Barak's response is very interesting, right? He says, I'll go if you go with me. But if you don't, I am out. Now, I think there's multiple ways to read this, but I think the best way to read this is that Barak recognizes who Deborah is. He looks at her. He knows her history. She is a judge. She has faithfully deliberated over the situations in this community, and she has done so faithfully for years. Again, she's got a tree named after her. Usually around here, you've got to die to get a tree named after you. Barak recognizes this, and he says, I'll go if you go with me. I recognize that you are a woman of faith, that you have a strong personality and a connection to God, and I know that I need that in my life and in this endeavor, and I'm willing to go if you go with me. He is not, actually, first off, it is not beneath him, he recognizes, to even ask her for support and help. It's not beneath him as a military commander that when she summons him, that he comes. And think about the people in positions of power that you would imagine when they were invited to come by someone who was, say, not up to their snuff, that they would say, well, whatever, I'm not bothering to do that. But Barak says it's not beneath me to come to you. And more than that, it's not beneath me to take directions from you. She's not a military commander. You know, she didn't go to West Point. You know, she doesn't have these stars and bars on her shoulders. She has no history of engaging in military conflict. And yet, he says, you're the one I'm going to listen to. I'm going to put my own history and success on the side. I'm going to listen to you. In fact, I'm not just going to listen to you, but if you're not with me, I'm not going to do it. Now, Deborah responds with something that I see in many situations been spoken almost as a judgment on him. She says, because of the path that you're taking, a woman is going to get the credit. On the one hand, you could say, it's because Barak is not faithfully stepping out and willing to do this, but I think it's a different angle. It never says anything that Barak has done anything wrong. I think what Deborah is simply stating are the facts. The course that God has set you on. Remember, Deborah calls him in, says, this is what the Lord's going to do. You need to step out, gather these people, go to this place. The Lord has handed them over to you. Deborah says, the course that you are set on is going to have a woman get the credit. Now, there are some of us men who might hear this and go, nah, no chance. I'm not going to let a woman get the credit for something that I did. Barak doesn't do that. Barak says, actually, we have nothing in here. Barak doesn't say anything recorded in response to this, which I think is huge. Barak just does it. A woman's going to get credit? Fine. Because Barak has the humility to do the right thing regardless of who gets credit for it. It doesn't matter that it's going to be a woman. It doesn't matter, there's going to be someone else. He is willing to do the right thing. He is humble enough to do the right thing regardless of who gets credit for it. And at the end of the story, this section, is an example of something that I think it's a little uncomfortable. There's a woman who shows up because the army is routed, and Sisera goes into a tent to seek safety, and there's a woman by the name of Jael. Jael, who takes a tent peg and drives it through his temple. Little bit, it's an example. Yeah, I feel a little uncomfortable about this. But that's kind of, in many ways, I think, besides the point of the story of Deborah and Barak in this place. We're going to learn a lot from the two of them in our own lives. and at the same time be uncomfortable with some of the facts of the case, right? I get a little uncomfortable when I hear about tent pegs being driven through the temples of people, even if they're my enemies, right? I would not be excited if I heard about somebody who, an opposing coach on the soccer field, who got a tent peg driven through their temple because they were trying to defeat us. I don't think that's a good. But Barak and Deborah have a unique story that is so, man, I think it just hits us right between the eyes in the way our world and our experiences are happening today, right? Courage and humility that are intertwined. We, despite the messiness that is around us, we can achieve a level of, well, success, even if I can use that word, through courage and humility. The courage to step out, to speak up, to speak the truth, which is difficult. It is in some ways easy to think we're speaking the truth. But as Deborah demonstrates, I think it's a relationship, it's an ongoing relationship with God that enables us to be able to know that what we're speaking is truth. And there's so many things that rub us the wrong way that it's so easy to just snap and say something and not even realize whether it's what God's inviting us to speak or not. That's why prayer is so vital and important. That's why a community is so vital and important. But humility is an integral piece of that. To be willing to hold things lightly, including ourselves. Does it matter if I get the credit? Does it matter if I'm the one who's remembered? Funny enough, in the story of Deborah and Barak, Jael, who commits the, who ends the war by killing Sisera, is actually an afterthought in the story. She only shows up for a few moments. I'm sure in the moments, right, Jael was probably the one who was lauded and celebrated and whatnot. She did this thing, but we are talking about Deborah and Barak, the two who were courageous and humble enough to do the right thing regardless. I was watching a movie last night, a movie I would hazard guess many of you have already seen. It's the movie The Jesus Revolution. And I was familiar with two of the three main characters in the movie. Don't worry, there's no spoilers. This actually happened for the most part, so I'm only spoiling it if you weren't alive during the 70s and 80s. But the story, as the movie portrays, is kind of the story of Greg Laurie. He was a pastor, evangelist. I was introduced to him in college as he would do crusades throughout the country. He's a pastor of a very large church out in California. And it's funny because, you know, he starts off in a very messy situation in his life, comes from a messy family background, doesn't even really know his actual birth father. In the 70s, you know, actually even in the, starts off in the late 60s, you know, engaging in drugs and seeking the truth and all, it's a messy situation. But he comes to faith, he has the courage to speak out, to step out, to let go of his past life and to be willing to follow Christ. And he becomes a tremendously well-known pastor, but he's not the one who, at least initially, is attempting to take any of the credit. Chuck Smith is the pastor. He's played by, I did this to myself, didn't I? Formerly Frasier. Kelsey Grammer, there we go. Don't ask me names, I'm so sorry. Kelsey Grammer plays Chuck Smith, who's a pastor of, at least as the movie portrays, a small and struggling church, who's who's humble enough to say, you know what, I'm going to open up the doors to people who I am tremendously uncomfortable about coming in. And through that, something amazing happens in that church. And he births a fellowship of churches called the Calvary Assembly. It's not what it's called. Anyway, that is really over 1,000 churches are a part of this assembly now. But the star of it, kind of like jail, actually, in the moment, he is, you know, huge, is a man that I had never, ever heard of by the name of Lonnie Frisbee. Lonnie has his own difficult situation. He actually died fairly young, I think about 43 years old when he died. But he was the kind of the hippie evangelist who looked so much like Jesus and is portrayed in this movie in a beautiful way. You know, always walking around barefoot, you know, hair longer than my shoulders, which to me, I'm like, oh, this makes me itchy just looking at it. But here he, you know, has the courage to step out and to speak this good news of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and the invitation to anybody. And who he engages with people regardless of where they are, where they're coming from. And all three of these men together help to, are a part of this Jesus revolution that swept the nation, right? Before I was even born. And yet you read this story and you see this movie and you're amazed because it seems like none of these men were really all that, well, concerned about who got the credit. The person who was the most famous at the time, Lonnie, is someone who I didn't even know about until I watched this movie. And the person who was probably the least in this situation, Greg, you know, who's a kid almost as the story begins, is the one who ends up getting the most acclaim, ends up rising to the highest heights. And here we have an example again of what it looks like to be courageous, but also to be humble. Be willing to do whatever it takes, regardless of who gets the credit, to be faithful to God. I'm grateful not just for them, not just even for Barack and Deborah, but I'm grateful for the many people just like that here in our church. We're perfect. None of us are. But I see it so often, especially the willingness to serve in a way that doesn't mean that the spotlight is shone on them, because they're willing to do whatever it takes to be faithful to God regardless of who gets the credit, who gets the acclaim. We all know who it belongs to. It is not me. It is not them. It is the one who went to that cross. And I'll tell you this, when we keep that, Christ, at the center of what we do, amazing things can happen. Let's pray. Humble God, you who have been willing to even allow us to make so many mistakes, willing to wade in to our messes, to put your very life on the line for us. God who is faithful, God who is sacrificial, God whose love has never known a limit. We thank you for what you have done, for what you are doing, the ways that you are engaged in ways that we can't imagine, wading into the messes and the violence in our world. God, we lift up to you what's going on right now in Israel. We lift up to you what continues to go on in Ukraine and Russia. God, we have opinions. But when we're honest, we know that it is a lot more difficult and a lot messier. And so we pray that you would continue to be at work. We pray for peace. We pray for your love, your truth, your light to shine in the hearts and the minds of those who are involved, God. And we pray that as we go back to our homes today, as we go back to our neighborhoods, as we go back to our jobs and the places that we serve, that we would be able to do so with the same humility that led you to love us. The same courage to step out with open hands. And we ask, we trust that you hear all of our prayers. And so we lift up our voices now to you. Hear us when we call. You are the star in the night sky. You are the sun that shines through the day. You are the peace that surpasses all understanding. And so we lift up to you ourselves as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Next to you is a reminder that we've been bound together by the love of Jesus Christ as we are sent out into this world now to welcome others to grow in Jesus. Hear these final words of good news. Friends, the light is shining. The light of Christ's love. The light of Christ's peace. The light of Christ's joy. Step into it with courage. and with humility, knowing that He is with you now and forevermore. Amen.